You're wrong. Okay? Secondly, when someone says, again, because of the inclusive nature of the church, for someone to say, if my child has special needs, we can't be a part of the church, is ridiculous. In fact, just today or yesterday, I just received an invitation to a celebration that Bishop Pine is presiding at the cathedral for other able people. So if that was the case, I don't know where folks are getting their information. Again, what people hear is very, very different than what's actually said. So there's some challenges there.
Mr. Radke over here.
Yes, Mr. Radke.
You want me to take the mic?
That's all right. Go ahead, Dan.
Can I be heard? Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Thank you.
I just appreciate what the book of Genesis said about homosexuality.
Hold it up like this.
What the book of Genesis said about homosexuality is interesting to me, and what the bishops have said is interesting to me, but I'm wondering if you can tell us what Jesus said about it.
Very interesting question.
Yeah.
Interesting. That's a very interesting question. And if you read the Gospels, he really doesn't make any kind of statement. And in fact, if you were to read Paul's letters, and in particular his first letter or his letter to the Romans in the first chapter. He doesn't come out and condemn people who are homosexual. What he comes out and does is he comes out and condemns the behavior. It's never the person, it's the behavior. And I don't think that Jesus would say anything different to the people who have same-sex attraction who were living in his town in Nazareth or wherever he was. He wouldn't say anything different to them as he said to the prostitutes, or the people who were caught in infidelity. At the end of the day, it's the behavior, it's not the person. And that's the difference. And that's what we need to focus on. I completely agree with you. I'm going back to you, my friend. Tell me your name again.
I'm going back to you. Too.
You come back. All right, you come back. All right, hold on a second.
Mark.
A second. So I'm coming back because the reality is that we haven't treated the person. We've only been focused on the act. I think that's the difference. Yes, ma'am.
Father, can you help me structure my reaction when homosexual people ask for or explaining things that they did together or showing their wedding pictures? And I do work in a field that does have a lot of homosexuals.
Sure.
I don't know what level of engagement.
It's a great question.
You don't need to know. We don't ask heterosexuals that.
It is true.
Wedding.
It is true.
No, not the act.
You know what? Actually, so you are asking me to help you develop a response to the folks with whom you work, who show you the pictures of their wedding. Or whatever.
Activities that they and their husband may have been involved in.
Like what kind of activities?
A trip.
Yeah.
Like a heterosexual.
You know what you can do? How was it?
Yeah.
Exactly.
I think that that's the answer. I think that's the question.
Yeah.
That we ask them. Because again, we're more interested in the person. I mean, that's where our focus needs to be. It needs to be on the person. You want it?
Yeah.
Okay, all right, go ahead, Mark.
So why is the Catholic Church so bent on the so-called marriage of the gay society? I believe that as much as I love Bishop Hine, I thought he kind of threw that letter out in his first month there about his negative response against the marriage of gay people. Mm-hmm. First of all, marriage is not a Catholicism terminology. Basically, it wasn't designed by the Catholic Church. It's basically a civil unity. Mm-hmm. A civil unity? Well, that's...
That's right.
The word of marriage didn't come in until the 12th century. It didn't come at the time of Jesus. It didn't come in the time of the Bible. It came in a much later time. So much of the Catholic Church wants to use the word marriage like they invented it. Now, hey, I have a sacred marriage because I was under the church and I have followed my vows. But I also understand the other scenario from them is that, and for those that aren't aware, for those that live as a unity couple, many of them have lived for the last 40 years in the closet, so to speak. When one dies, guess what happens? It doesn't go to the other person. Everybody else can come in. Well, at least I have the satisfaction of living. I have health insurance and all that. My wife is going to get the benefit of it. They don't. But our society wants to continue to fight it. The Catholic Church continues to fight it.
What the Catholic Church is really interested in doing is that it's interested in preserving the understanding of the sacramental relationship between Jesus and the man and the woman. Again, what's really, we just have to continue to go back to the foundation. In fact, the Genesis passage is one of the prescribed texts for the celebration of the sacrament of marriage. So it's not a Catholic thing. It actually comes out of the Judeo-Christian tradition. So it's not just, okay, well, one day the Catholic Church said, okay, we're going to establish the sacrament of marriage. It actually came from the Jewish tradition. And then it's evolved over time to what we understand it today.
But those that want to get married, they're not busting, the gay society is not busting down the Catholic churches to get married in the Catholic Church.
Well, because they can't.
Well, I don't think they want to because they're pushed back anyway.
Well, I know, well, okay.
They're trying to get married civilly for other purposes other than just the unity of the marriage.
Sure, I get you.
So, I'm just throwing this stuff out because, you know, we hear it in society, but I'm hearing it firsthand because my son's not involved in that, so I'm not considering it. But he has many, many older friends that have fought the battle for the last 30 years. You know, the gay society was, you know, if you were gay in 85, facing AIDS, and that was another thing I mentioned about AIDS and HIV. Mm-hmm. If you learn about HIV and AIDS, it wasn't about gays. Mm-hmm. That wasn't the cancer of the gays.
Right.
That was basically a problem that turned out, it eventually got rectified. But again, if you were in the 80s or 90s, you're pretty much in the closet. Mm-hmm. You're not coming out. In fact, in most countries, you're stoned to death.
Sure.
In this country, a few have, but mostly it's civil.
Questions from the back. Okay, you know what? I'm gonna draw four quick conclusions, and then I'm gonna answer these two questions from the back, and then I will take. We'll open the floor for any other questions. Okay. All right. Good for it. Shake your hand.
Yes.
So these are some conclusions that I just want to share with you. So first of all, I'm going to own it. We haven't done a good job of doing this, but the church invites into relationship with Jesus people of same sex attraction as much as people of opposite sex attraction. Again, we haven't done a very good job of it, but it's still the reality. When, you know, as a church, we need to be about inviting people of same-sex attraction into a relationship with Jesus just as much as people of opposite-sex attraction. Secondly, let me say it this way, we cannot show discrimination, but we can call people to holiness, to living in accord with God's plan and will and design. It doesn't need to be. And the church is telling us, the magisterium, the teaching authority of the church is telling us, we cannot discriminate if we're really going to say that everyone has equal dignity, equal value. We just simply need to invite them to respond to the call to holiness. Third, the real key to the whole deal is what? Chastity. Engaging our ability to relate to one another, male to male, female to female, male to female, with the fullness and the authenticity that is appropriate to our state in life. And this isn't about focusing on what we have. People say, well, does that mean you have to abstain? Okay, I guess you could say that, but I want us to have a different perspective. That this, you know, that when we talk about chastity, this isn't about focusing on what we can't have, but focusing on what we do have. And that is to say, we do have the opportunity to enter into meaningful, intimate relationships with people that are not genital and don't need to be genital. Okay. And then, and also in remembering that our genital expression does not define us and who we are. And then the last thing is that, again, the church as an inclusive body welcomes everyone. St. Paul says it, we're neither Jew nor Greek, nor slave nor free, we are all one in Christ. And that's what we have to remember. That those of us who have been baptized into a life with Christ are one body. And we need to welcome all the members. All right. There you have it. That's all I got. Thank you. So these are the questions from the back room?
Yes.
Yeah.
All right. So, there are two. The Catholic Church's position on denying service to gay weddings and discrimination. So I hope, at some level, I've addressed that. I mean, at the end of the day, you know, it's not that the Church doesn't want to, or let me put it this way, it's not that the Church excludes people of same-sex attraction from getting married. The deal is that it can't. It's not ours to change. It's a divinely instituted, or it's given to us as a gift. It's divinely instituted. Marriage is divinely instituted. Again, it's not, and so the Holy Father can't just come down one day and say, you know what, anybody regardless of race, orientation, whatever, you all get married. Because at the end of the day, when you go back to the biblical foundation, it's very, very clear what that's about. And Mark, you're absolutely right. Our society still, you know, it doesn't allow, the property when a couple's together and one of the partners dies. You're right. That property goes everywhere else but to the other partner. You're absolutely right. And is that just? No. But I know there are lots of people who are lobbying for that. Do you want to say something?
Yes, sure. Keep going back to the Genesis reading.
Yeah.
But aren't we taught as Catholics that we don't adhere to a literal interpretation of the scriptures? That they're divinely inspired, but we don't take every scripture literally, like that really happened.
We do not interpret. Let me say it this way. I'm going to choose my words carefully. No, we don't. As Catholics, we do not literally interpret the scriptures. But there are some passages, there are words, there are images that are so clear, you don't have to interpret them. It's right there in front of you. And so, you're right, I keep going back to that passage because it's so fundamental. Because it lays the foundation for how we understand the intrinsic value of a human person.
The sad thing is these people were created by God, and this is the way God created them.
Absolutely.
And that's the part that is so hard to...
You know what, no, actually, this is what...
I understand chastity part, but
you know, we didn't address this question. Her question is really interesting. This is the way that God created them. I'm going to argue no. I'm going to argue that same-sex attraction is an effect of the fall. Of the fall. Of the fall of Adam and Eve. Okay. That again, you know, when you talk about, and again, this is not a commentary on the value of those people. But the reality is that it is an effect of the fall.
So are we.
Absolutely. You know what? Cancer. How many of you in this room have had cancer? An effect of the fall. How many of you have poor eyesight? Effect of the fall.
Before Adam and Eve
made the choice,
right,
to contradict God's command,
right,
not to eat of the fruit of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, that they were perfect. They enjoyed complete and total freedom. They enjoyed perfection. Everything was good. After the moment that they decided to consume what they were told not to consume, was the moment that they experienced imperfection, and you and I, as their descendants, experienced that imperfection as well. And that imperfection gets manifested in lots and lots of different ways, from illness to disability, and lots and lots of different things. You want to talk? All right. Okay, go ahead.
Well, I'm a little bit nervous, so this is hard for me. As you know, I'm married to Mark, and we do have a son who is gay. And I know that I disagree with Father Kevin, and I guess I disagree if he's representing the church, and I disagree with the church. I believe that anyone who is gay, that God made them that way. I don't think he made a mistake. I don't think it's an imperfection at all whatsoever. And I hope anyone here who has a child who's gay, or there's a 14-year-old or 15-year-old here who is gay, or a woman, that they know that they are loved, that God made them that way, and he loves them, that they will go on to have beautiful, wonderful lives and contribute to our society. And I don't think that they are lesser than, you know. I'll say right now, I don't believe in the church telling them that they have to, they better, you know, be with friends that are balanced. That's kind of the impression I got from your words. My son has beautiful friends, and they in turn have other friends too. He happens to be gay because he was born that way. He did not choose it. And God loves him more than anything, like he loves all of us here in this room more than anything. So, God is love.
And I completely agree with you. This is the challenge. The challenge is that we can place a value judgment on imperfection. Imperfection isn't necessarily, and please understand it, heterosexuality is not the fulfillment of perfection either. I mean, it's just the state in which we come into the world, and it's the way in which we relate to the world. It's not bad, it's not good. No, it's what we do with it that's challenging. But it's what we do with it. It's not who we are, it's not bad in itself. Yeah, Tom.
You know,
you're gonna get the microphone. Sorry.
Paul and I have been married for 39 years, and we have 4 sons. They all were raised in the Catholic Church. They all were altar boys. They all were altar boys, all 4 of our sons. Got them spread pretty far apart. 36 and 35 and 23 and 20. 37, I'm sorry. Anyway, they all were raised in the Catholic Church. They all loved the Lord. And then our oldest son, who's now 37, came out when he was 16, okay. I'm getting old, I can't remember. He came out when he was 16, and it was the hardest thing I ever had to go through. But I think about how hard it was for him. And it was nothing to me, it was nothing compared to his. And he always was very spiritual. And but he isn't anymore because of the Catholic Church and the way he feels. And I can understand the way he feels just from listening to some of the comments around the room here, the whispers and things are being said. I can understand, because if they knew he was gay when he was sitting in the church, he would probably hear the same thing. And that makes me sad. And as far as being born or wanting to be, or you know, choosing to be gay, you're born gay. You're born gay. My son said to me, he says, "Dad, do you think that I thought when I was a little kid, because I knew when I was about 10 that I was different, I didn't really understand it till later. He said, but you think I thought, man, I can't wait till I grow up, I'm going to be gay. He said, I don't want to be gay. This is the way God made me. I can't help that. You know, he has control over what he does. You know, he doesn't have to act on it. If he does, it's a sin. Just like some of the people that run around, guys that run around on their wives, the wives that run around on their husbands. You know? We welcome all sinners in church. Jesus spent all of his time with sinners. He didn't go in, you know, that's where he was with the sinners. And I think the church needs to be much more welcoming. I love that this is here tonight. But I think you need to do something in the community to know, let people in the community know whether you're Catholic or you're looking for somewhere to go, that you are welcome if you're gay.
I'm just going to end my last statement here just to basically say this talk is about one thing, homosexuality. I can guarantee you, if I saw that poster said it was going to talk about heterosexuality, there have been 20 people here tonight. So we know it's a very controversial and a subject in which everybody wants to know something. The only thing I would say is that for those that have not experienced, for those that think they don't know anybody, let me tell you, if you work in your environment, you're working with them. Just because they don't tell you anything, just like nobody tells you what their heterosexual activities are, doesn't mean that you don't know who you're sitting next to. So they're sitting in your church, and they're sitting in your environments there. So just, yeah, you're right. Yeah, but they are in our church too.
Absolutely.
But they're closeted in our church. But I will tell you that this, and I appreciate you doing that tonight. I appreciate your comments, and I appreciate everybody listening to me, and I have appreciated all your comments and everything also. Thank you.
Okay. Yep. Rick.
Father, if you receive an invitation to a gay couple's wedding, is it all right to go?
I think you should call your bishop.
Tough one, eh?
769-1919. This is, you know, and that's a really, really challenging question. Because again, if we want to, again, if it's about the person, and then we want to support the person, we want to be in relationship with the person, then, you know, obviously that's part of being a person. You got. Tom's got to say something.
I got to.
All right. Okay. Hold on a second. Go ahead.
My son.
Hold on. Here you go.
My son has never been married.
Uh-huh.
But he knows how I feel about it.
Sure.
I'll go there because I love him, but not because I agree with him.
Right.
He knows that it's between man and woman. That's the way that he was brought up. That's what I believe in the church, you know. And my wife may disagree with me, that's okay. But,
Okay. You know, honestly, I know it sounds like a bit of a cop out, but I probably would go to the bishop and say, you know what? What would you counsel me to do? Because it's a hard thing. Again, I think that there's, I agree with Tom. I think that, you know, we need to make sure we're we're not alienating each other, you know? And that really, Mark, when I hear the church doesn't, what I'm hearing is that the larger body of Christ is not living charity. Now, granted, the leadership needs to do it too, you know? The leadership needs to put out the example. But, you know, it's also the case that the body has.
I think an answer to that gentleman, though, is that would be a judgment call.
It would be a judgment call. I mean, for me, I see this. This is a conflict for me, Rick, because you know what? It's a very, very different game for me to be at a wedding than it would be for you to be at a wedding. So I think there's some challenges there. Probably, yeah. I would have to give that some. I would have to ask some other opinions.
Are we afraid that that's going to be a sin if we intend to?
No, I don't think. No, it's not. No.
Well, that's okay. That's what I was wondering.
I don't think there's any.
I mean, I don't. I wouldn't see it that way either.
Is it okay to go to a gay wedding?
Since Rome doesn't recognize gay weddings. You're not actually going to a wedding.
So what's wrong with going in?
It's not recognized.
You ask yourself the same question. You know, if it is true, this is a very interesting rationale. So if it's the case, let's say for fun, Tom, that you have some friends who are being civilly married. So they're having a big civil ceremony at the gazebo. And they're having a big reception afterwards. Would you go? Would you give any thought to that at all?
Yeah.
No. So just go.
Right.
So I'm not sure if there's a difference.
Absolutely.
I'm not sure if there's a difference. I don't know. I'm on tape. I don't know.
A gay person does not experience homosexuality. It's originally.
Okay.
It may be the wrong, the church looks at it as the wrong thing to have them decide that originally, mm-hmm. but they don't seek it, they don't experience it, they are.
All right, so hold on a second. I'm just going to repeat this for people to hear. Is that people of same-sex attraction do not experience the attraction. It is intrinsic to who they are.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. And then the second thing?
I have an experience. I walk out the door and get hit by a car. That's an experience. It's a one-time happening.
Sure.
But to a gay person, they have it from the time that they are aware of it until they go to their grave.
Okay.
So it's not an experience.
Fair.
And,
I'm not arguing that.
I heard that word, orientation. We are sitting here, I assume the Muslims are heterosexual, and we cannot possibly feel what you're saying, but homosexual here is the Catholic Church. That your sexual feelings expressed are sinful, but we want you to come to the church and give up something that God gave you. That's the incongruity.
I'm not saying that.
No, you're not saying.
I'm not sure the leadership is saying that.
Well, you have to go to communion. Can you stop expressing your love for your spouse?
You can love anybody all you want. I mean, the line, let's call it what it is. The line is drawn with genital expression. But again, I'm going to go back to my original argument. There's a lot of passion behind this for me. Is that at what point in time is genital expression the only way in which for us to communicate love to other people? It's not the only way,
right.
And it's not the best way.
It isn't the only way, but it is a way.
It is a way, but it's not the only way. And the reason why this has some fire behind this for me is because does that mean that I can't love?
No.
Exactly.
No, but it means that people who engage in sexual relations, it doesn't mean that it means that they can love with that too.
Yeah.
It's one of their ways of loving.
It's true. It is a way of loving.
Yeah.
But it is not the only way of loving.
Right.
So my question is, why what is it necessary for the arsenal, for lack of a better word? You know, because, again, I don't have any challenge loving people, but I'm not doing it genitally.
But you're a priest.
Doesn't make any sense.
We're still having
I know my wife, I have changed away besides
right, just sexual. Right, but I'm just saying, don't take that away. You know, sure. The church wants to take it away from them.
We're gonna. So, okay, you know what? I know there's probably a lot of other questions that you want to ask, but I want to respect your time and I'm getting the book. So
I'm getting closer.
You wanna go ahead?
Bingo.
Oh, thank you. You are awesome. Where you were signing in, Sandy has all kinds of materials that she is willing to sell you from
Queen of Angels.
Sorry. Long day. Okay? So there, plus will you pick a ticket, please?
Okay,
All right, 831-1242. All right, Mrs. Werner.
Okay, so this is a $10.
Listen.
This is a $10 script card to Just Osmos. If you're coming back next week, remember, you can use script, so you can stop at church
by script. Thank you, Father. It's been really a wonderful evening.
I just appreciate your tolerance of me, and I hope that some of this has been helpful, and it's been actually helpful for me as well. So just know that I realize that many of us are affected by, or know people who have this intrinsic orientation, and I want you to know that for myself as a leader in the church, that I really do want to extend that welcome. So God bless you, my friends. Have a great night.
And thank you.